Alright, so episodes 5 and 6 just ended, and I have notes. I have like a page full of notes on my phone that we're just gonna go through because there was a lot on this episode, particularly episode 5. Episode 6 really was kind of, honestly, it was kind of probably the weakest episode where there really wasn't much interesting going on. But we'll get to that. Episode 5, I think, had the most heat, most meat in it, so yeah, let's start with that. Okay, first of all, off the bat, it's like sad, right? Right as the episode starts, boom, text, in loving memory of Kobe Bryant. I'm like, oh, okay, it's gonna be one of those episodes. Okay, it's gonna be that right now. Just like right at the beginning, they're starting it off with the feels, like, okay. And then they show how, you know, it was funny. Jordan calls him little Laker boy in the locker room of the All-Star game. They both go back and forth during the game. And then that picture with, you know, Jordan meeting Kobe after the game, you know, oh, I'm gonna see you later, all right, cool. That was like the start of what became like, not even like a friendship, like a brotherhood, you know? Like Kobe, because Kobe said in the episode, you know, it was like, hey, that was my big brother. Jordan is my big brother. He was that figure for me, you know? Like there weren't a lot of players that Jordan really had respect for in that way. But for Kobe, it was different. And you could tell that Kobe felt that way too when you hear him speak about him. You know, he shuts down the greatest of all time argument when you know, he gets he admits he doesn't like getting compared to Jordan because in his eyes, he wouldn't have the 5 championships he has without Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan basically helped shape Kobe to be the player that we knew him as. So it was good to see Kobe. First of all, it was just nice to see him there. It was hard to watch, honestly, but it was nice to see him actually shut down the dumbest arguments for the greatest of all time, because honestly, that discussion is annoying. I hate it, and I love that he was just like, nope, I'm not about it either. So I think that was great. I love that he did that, and I don't know, it's still tough to me, you know. It's been what, almost 4 months since he passed, and it still really doesn't hit. So when watching him there, you know, in that documentary, watching him speak, it still feels like he's still here, you know. So I don't know, man, it's tough, but it was still good to see him speak in the way he did about Michael Jordan, because you could tell it was genuine with them. Alright, so then all the emotional stuff got out of the way, and then the not fun stuff, the interesting stuff. Okay, let's start with this. So Jordan, Michael Jordan, Adidas fumbled the bag, man. Adidas, they screwed up. Like, they were so dysfunctional, and Jordan still wanted to sign with them. Jordan still wanted to sign with Adidas, until his mom came in and convinced him to sign with Nike. And the funny thing is, Jordan didn't even want to sign with Nike. He didn't even like Nike. He wanted to go with Adidas. But the problem was, Michael Jordan's mom has that mom vision, and she saw that Adidas was a mess. And they wouldn't have been able to treat Jordan the way he did, the way Nike has. So, man, imagine if Jordan went with Adidas. Would he still have those? Like, he wouldn't have those iconic shoes. They wouldn't be as iconic, or they could have been, but they would have been completely different from what we know now. You know, the OG ones would have been completely different. Like, imagine those Jordan shoes with Adidas. Imagine, would he have became like the global cultural icon that he did if he didn't have those specific shoes? Because those shoes are so iconic. And they talk about it in the episode about how Jordan, in his last game versus the Knicks at the Garden, he's playing with those shoes on. And those shoes are terrible to play in. And he still did it, you know. His feet were bleeding, his socks were dripped in blood, and he still did it because he was having a good game. But it's still wild to me that those shoes have such an iconic look to it, and it's not even basketball related, you know. Because, I mean, Jordan says when they were created, they were for basketball, but then obviously all the stuff happened. But then after that, it just became a cultural figure, that shoe. All these people going in lines to buy it, all this money. It was $108 with tax to get those shoes. You could go on GOAT or StockX right now. They are worth like thousands of dollars, probably even $10,000 plus, which is ridiculous. But I mean, it goes to show just how much of a cultural influence he had, you know? All those endorsements. They talk about the endorsements also. Jordan, what else did he have? Gatorade, McDonald's, all the big brands were, you know, Jordan did all the stuff, all that stuff with them, and it, like, you know, it gave him all of that, you know, it gave him all of that publicity around the world, you know, so that he wasn't just known as a basketball player, he was known as, like, a cultural figure. So that was cool to see. And then that's also what led to that controversy where Jordan talks about, oh, Republicans buy sneakers too, which was interesting, because I don't think I've ever heard him actually talk about that quote, because that quote gets thrown around a lot, but I feel like sometimes the context is missing, so I don't like to really think about what he meant by it until I hear it from him. So he kind of clarified it, kind of, but I don't know, it was still interesting to hear him speak that way and how it, like, affected people in that community and how they felt about the way he spoke or the actions he had. They felt that he didn't do enough politically to, like, help people in the community and whatnot. So that was interesting to see. What else did they talk about? There was a lot in this episode alone. Like, most of the notes I have are just from episode 5. Okay, we need to talk about this. I talked about this on the last video, but the soundtrack, my god, they played Can I Kick It, Tribe Called Quest, Outkast. They showed the Bulls playing in Atlanta in front of 60,000 people, and they had that gameplay to Outkast. Like, come on, man. They had all the classic stuff playing. Like, they need to take the soundtrack, every single song they had playing, they need to put it on a Spotify playlist and something, and I guarantee you it will blow up. I will download that playlist right away. I don't know, it's probably out there somewhere, to be honest, but I just haven't gone out of my way to look for it. But if I do, I probably will find it, and then I'll download it and bump it, because they picked such good music. Like, whenever they show Jordan playing, they show, like, his highlights, that's when I know they're gonna play some fire, and they do. They come through every time. So I don't know who decides that stuff, but they did a terrific job with it. They talk about the 1992 finals, and then they show, of course, the iconic Shrug game, 6 threes and a half, which is, you know what, the weird thing is, that sounds, at the time, you could imagine how crazy that was for him to do 6 threes and a half, but when you think about how the game is played now, that's possible. You know, we've seen crazier. I mean, you watch what Steph Curry or Klay Thompson or any of these other shooters we have right now do, so, you know, 6 threes and a half doesn't sound as crazy, you know, when you had Klay Thompson hitting 14 in a game or whatever, you know. So it's still crazy to me, you know. So a lot of new people will say, oh my god, he only hit 6 and a half, but think about what 6 and a half was like in 1992, you know? That was never done before, so of course it was going to be a huge deal. They showed the finals, they showed how they won against the Blazers pretty easily, to be fair, which was interesting. And then after the finals was the Olympics, and of course it was, you know, the iconic Dream Team. And of course, with the Dream Team and Michael Jordan, they had to talk about Isaiah Thomas and how he wasn't on the team, which is still funny to me because you could tell that Jordan still hates him. Maybe not personally as much anymore because it's been a lot of time since, but I mean, he even said, he's like, I respected the player. He was a good player, but I hated his guts. And I just, like, for me, that's like, I still don't, it, to me, they still hate each other. Like, I don't even know if Isaiah hates him as much, but I feel like Michael really just, like, can't stand him. And I mean, you could argue, like, hey, can you blame him? Maybe not, but it's still interesting to see how, like, how much you could tell that, like, Jordan still gets so pissed when he thinks about, like, Isaiah Thomas, which is still funny. I don't mind it. It's funny. They showed that practice, the Dream Team practice, that, like, legendary practice footage that we've never seen before. Michael's talking trash, Barkley's talking trash, Jordan's talking trash. Jordan, like, scores a bunch of points and drops on Magic a bunch of times. Magic gets angry and kicks the ball in the stands. He complains about the ref calls. It was still, like, we've seen the Dream Team stuff. There is a documentary on the Dream Team, which is a terrific documentary, by the way. You should watch it because it's so good. But they didn't even have that footage on there. So to see it in this documentary is sick, because it gives us a new insight into the Dream Team, because we hear about it all the time. But to see it in that way is, obviously, you can't go wrong with anything new like that. So speaking of the Dream Team, Tony Kukoc, let's go. We got some Tony Kukoc stands in the building. They talked about his life story. Obviously, he came from a pretty rough environment. You know, he lived in the middle of a war, poverty, all that stuff was going on, and he was playing for Croatia. And obviously, that first game was, Jordan and Pippen wanted to cook him, and they did. And why? Because of Jerry Krause. Because Jerry Krause was all about Tony Kukoc. Oh, this is the next guy. He's going to be the future. After Jordan and Pippen are gone, we're going to have him, and everything's going to be great. And Jordan and Pippen were like, hell no, you still have us. You're talking about the future, you still have us. They go to Tony Kukoc, and they cook him in the first game against Croatia. Like, it was so bad. Like, you almost feel bad. They bullied him. And even they even showed Pippen after the game saying, no, he doesn't deserve to be in the NBA. Like, if he got scared against us, what makes you think he's going to play in the NBA? That's wild to me. And it's still funny how they ended up as teammates. It's still interesting to me. And then, obviously, you know, that happens. And then they play in the gold medal game. And Tony Kukoc, you know, all of a sudden, you know, these Dream Team people forget where Tony Kukoc came from, you know. This guy came from war and poverty. You don't think he has a little edge to him? And he had that edge in the gold medal game. Obviously, they still lost, but it was still like Tony, he wasn't getting bullied as much. You know, he did the work. So it was still fun to watch that. So when they won the game, they showed how Jordan didn't want to be shown with anything of Reebok, and how the people at Reebok were like, hey, if you don't show off that Reebok gear when you're taking that gold medal, don't even think about the medal. You can take it away from us. And that's wild, you know? Like, that brand. And Jordan obviously was pissed, because he's a very business-minded guy. So he obviously didn't want to be seen with Reebok when he's one of Nike's biggest stars. So the way he did it was he covered the Reebok logo with the US flag, which honestly doesn't sound as clever, but when you think about it, it's kind of sleek. And you know, when you think about it now, all these Olympians, when they get their medals and stuff, they always cover themselves in the flags, not even just the US, any other country. But to see Jordan do that just to hide, it's like, it's very clever. So he was not only a genius on the court, he was a genius off the court, and it was funny to watch. We're almost done. Okay, what else would we have? So that was most of episode 5. So Sam Smith, who was a journalist who was covering like the Bulls and stuff, did a he did a book about like the inside about the Bulls, because people knew about the Bulls on the outside, but they wanted to know the like behind the scenes stuff. And he did a lot of that, and he got a lot of dirt from somebody. And when the book came out, obviously Jordan got a lot of backlash about, you know, people saw, oh, he's a bad teammate and whatnot. It got all that like backlash. And then one of the funny things was, hey, who is the one who gave Sam Smith, the journalist, all this information? So Jordan automatically thinks like, oh yeah, it was Horace Grant. And Horace Grant's like, no, it wasn't me. So now somebody's lying. That means, right? Somebody is lying. We don't know who. It could be Jordan. It could be Horace Grant. It could be Sam Smith. We don't know who gave him all that information, but it's still funny that that speculation still exists. Like, we still don't know. Last thing. So towards the beginning of episode 6, they also talked about the three-peat, which I don't think was as interesting. They talked about how, you know, the Bulls were down 0-2 against the Knicks, and then, you know, that caused a spark and a fire, because it was at the time when Jordan had the gambling stuff came up, how Jordan went to Atlantic City before the game. He looked very lethargic on the court, and all that happened, and all that like stuff came about, which was interesting to see. And Everyone knows that Jordan was a gambler, but like, he was a gambler. Like, he gambled with a dude named Slim and got in legal trouble. What did he expect to happen? He gambled with a dude named Slim. Like, come on. What are you doing? They talked about how some of the Bulls players who had played cards and stuff, they were on the front of the plane because they weren't the ones gambling hundreds and thousands of dollars. They were doing like $1 or $10. And Jordan would still get in their ear about gambling, which was still funny. And he said, I don't have a gambling problem. I have a competitiveness problem, which is interesting. You know, I don't know. I agree. I mean, that definitely seems like his argument. You know, no, I'm just not obsessed with gambling. I'm obsessed with winning. And that obsession with winning made me a gambler. Kind of. I could see that. I mean, Jordan was a psychopath in a way. Like, he said that, oh, if you watch this documentary, it's gonna make me look bad. It doesn't really make him look bad. It just makes him look, in a way, it makes him look cooler, honestly. It also shows how much more funnier he is. Because you don't think of Jordan as, like, a funny guy. Because you think of, like, the crazy competitive guy who always wants to win no matter what. But the dude was funny. Like, he was genuinely funny. Like, during the documentary, he's funny. And also, like, those times where they show him, like, you know, on the camera playing that coin toss game with that mullet guy who did the shrug, which was still funny. That meme is everywhere on Twitter now. What else is there? Oh, yeah. The man was golf obsessed, too. Like, that's wild to me. Like, I get golf is, like, a thing that a lot of people play, but, like, that man was crazy about golf. That was wild. Alright, I think that I covered everything. This was not as long. This video is not as long as I thought it would be, which, I guess, I covered most of it. Like, all my notes on my phone are done, so I think I'll just wrap it up here. Thank you guys for watching. You guys know the deal. Subscribe, leave a like, comment, everything. And, I'll see you guys in the next one. Peace. We'll be right back.